Welcome. Thank you for joining us for the midweek edition of Journalist Hangout. I'm Ayodele Ozubakun. Today on the program, police rescue 8 students and staff of the Nigerian Turkish International School in Ogun State. Northern governors now vow to collectively fight insecurity in their region. And later on the Hangout, Boko Haram attacked a Borno village, kills 8, abducts women and children. Babajide Kolade Otitoju, Tebia Prince Will, and Abdullah Yusuf will hang out with me today. So if you are ready, let the Hangout start. The kidnapped student and staff of the Nigerian Turkish school in Ogun State have been rescued. They were released about 7:30 p.m. Nigerian time on Tuesday after spending 11 days in captivity. The 5 students and the 3 staff of the school located in Isheri area of Ogun State were kidnapped on January the 13th. Sources say the parents parted with about 10 million naira each to secure the release of the students and staff. But the police have denied the payment of any ransom as usual. How can we end kidnapping in Nigeria? Should Nigerians believe no ransom was paid? Jide, let me start from you. Effectively, armed robbery is becoming unpopular in Nigeria. So the next game now is kidnapping. It's so lucrative that people pay ransom. They're always even afraid to say it out that they paid ransom. And it is when maybe the police round off the culprits after some days, you get to know that they paid ransom and some of them are paraded with this ransom money or what they bought with the ransom money. What can we do? It's becoming a national embarrassment. It's not safe anywhere in Nigeria again. Not east, west, south. It started from the Niger Delta region and it was imported to all the parts of every other part in Nigeria.
Basically, we cannot defeat kidnapping in Nigeria without deploying the appropriate technology. A lot of our communities ought to have CCTV coverage. For example, generally criminals dread places where they know have CCTV coverage because they know they'll be caught. In Durban, South Africa, for example, crime wave is lower than even Johannesburg because there is effective CCTV coverage of Durban. So if you commit crime in some parts of Durban, it's not possible to cover every part. Mm. That would be very expensive. But criminals know that if they commit crime in many parts of Durban, they will be caught. So they would rather stay away and go and commit crime where chances are that they will not be caught. In Nigeria, I think there was an attempt to come up with the CCTV project in Abuja, but somehow it failed. I don't know why exactly it failed. Yeah. If you observed, Isheri has repeatedly been targeted by kidnappers. Some landlords were jogging
the
other day
in the morning, the one estate,
and in broad daylight these guys came and took them away. These days in Nigeria, you could be shopping in a supermarket and some people will be inside the car just waiting for you to come out, and then you get taken away. It is true that armed robbery is becoming unfashionable in Nigeria. It's no longer fashionable because you stand the risk of being caught and given the necklace treatment. Whereas kidnappers hardly get caught in the act. They hardly get caught and they make tons of cash. Forget about the stories that no ransom was paid.
10 million naira each.
I think 3 days
seven
ago.
7 or 8, yeah. That's
3 days ago, the police came out to say the kidnappers had not demanded for ransom, and I was just laughing because what kidnappers usually tell members of the family of victims is, look, if you get the police involved, we'll kill the victim. So they always advise them, don't talk to the police. So those victims' families usually do not even let the police know that they are talking to kidnappers. So for a policeman to come out to say that the kidnappers had not even made any demand for ransom, I just felt, what are they talking about? Remember the Nigerian footballer based in Italy, Christian Ogbodo. He came home and was kidnapped in Delta State. The Nigerian police claimed that no ransom was paid. But the family came out to say, we paid $50,000 ransom. It was the club that paid the ransom. They sent word to the club that, look, this guy is in captivity. And they sent money. Ransom was paid. Remember the case of Olufalai too?
Yes.
When the then IG,
Inspector General Solomon Arase,
on TV was lying that no ransom was paid.
And but they're always saying that they rescued the victims.
Olufalai was asked to go and stay. They released him. They dropped him at a popular junction. And at that popular junction, he contacted his people. And then the police also
met him
and took him away, only to tell us that he was rescued. The one that I found really scandalous, you know, that made me to come to the conclusion that we never believe it when the police said no ransom was paid, was that of Lagos here. The children, those kids, what's the school again?
The school.
The seminary, junior seminary.
In Ikorodu?
Yes, they told us no ransom was paid. On the day the kidnappers were paraded before newsmen,
we were talking about the
cash. Boy was saying, one of them was saying, see, was that we were shortchanged, that the ransom that. So I said, and all along they told us no ransom was paid.
Well, you know, for me, it's unfortunate we keep discussing the symptoms of all of these issues as opposed to, you know, going.
Because I wanted to ask you, Chief Ozekwume, he addressed a press conference after his audio with these kidnappers, and he was saying that
80 million as ransom.
80 million as ransom, that most of these guys, that all of them, they were graduates.
That's what I was about to go. You know, there are two issues here. The first is we don't pay enough attention to social issues in this country, you know. You have a large population of unemployed youth, and you think they're just going to sit down and wait forever for opportunities that don't come, or that they're just going to keep watching other people get opportunities, and that they forever and ever will accept that I don't deserve my own chance. There's nowhere in the world where that happens. At some point, someone gets an idea, which is very often criminal, but it's human nature. You need to survive, you need to clothe yourself, feed yourself, live life. That's what we're all here to do at the end of the day, you know. So until we start talking about social issues, what to do with our young people, we'll forever be facing, you know, all of these things. I mean, it's amazing that after so many years of these things happening all over the country, we keep talking about it over and over and over again, but nothing is done. No investments are ever made. Or when investments are made in the people, you know, the money goes out, but the projects don't happen. You know, the projects don't happen. Instead, it's token things like we're going to give 100 motorcycles, 50 sewing kits. That's it's pointless. It goes nowhere. And that is not even 5 to 10% of the actual money budgeted to empower, you know, those communities. So it's unfortunate that this is happening, because what really needs to happen is for young people to realize that even this kidnapping, at some point you will get caught. It might take a while, but it happens. You will get caught, and what will happen in Lagos, for example, with this death penalty that has been voted.
State House of Assembly.
So what young people need to do is to come together and to finally, once and for all, like citizens all over the world do when they believe that their government is not investing in them, put pressure on the appropriate people to really. Let's see developments, you know, for Nigerians, not even just young Nigerians, for Nigerians across the world, which we're not seeing. Then the second thing now is the security agencies that use methods of the 1940s and 50s to try and track and investigate criminals or cases. Of course, you have, you know, young savvy graduates who have technology at their disposal.
But to be fair to our police, they've been busting this 80% of all, let's say 60% of the kidnap cases we
you
have,
know, a lot
they
of
end
the
up
time,
being apprehended.
A lot of the, a lot of the time,
after,
exactly.
After ransom,
a lot
yes.
of the time,
no,
that's, you know,
they don't preempt.
And there's a reason why in the U.S. they say, the U.S. government says we don't dialogue, we don't bargain with terrorists or anybody trying to hold us ransom, because it encourages it. So the next person says, okay, these guys were paid 10 million, I'm going to demand 20. Mm. Next person says, I'll demand 30. And things keep rising like that. So when does it end? You know, people, it's really unfortunate.
I was shocked, Adeola, when, you know, I think 48 hours, the CBN, the wife of the CBN governor, I think she was she rescued? But I was told she ended up paying ransom. Mm-hmm. They got the people, but they still had to pay this ransom. It shows the level of, I don't know, public, there are people, they don't have trust and belief in our security agencies. So they end up paying this ransom
can
before
you blame them?
Before can anybody you can do anything.
it's unfortunate, but can you blame them?
The truth that is staring us in the face, which I think we are yet to realize, is that this is a very lucrative industry. Mm-hmm. Aside from the oil industry, I don't see an industry that's as lucrative as this kidnapping. Okay, 8 abductees in 11 days, you said.
Mm.
And the ransom of close to 80 million is paid. If each of them is paid the ransom of 80 million. So
that's
please 80 tell million. Me, please what tell me a business you exactly. do. That will, so that is one. Another thing that I think is very, very germane in this discussion is the manner in which the abductees were rescued, quote and unquote. And from reports, the parents were at the police college waiting, based on the arrangement they had with the kidnappers, to welcome their kids. Whereas, the kidnapper had to take the kids to the abductees, to the school where they were kidnapped.
Mm.
That will tell you something. And what that tells you is that, although we have kidnapping all around the country, but it's so rampant at areas that you have swamp, areas
yes.
that
yeah.
you have.
Water,
it's so rampant, riverine area. And even if you talk of trying to ensure that social amenities, if we are trying to ensure that there is CCTV coverage, these are areas that the government will think about last. And what I want us to now realize is that it has come to the fore that it's important that the government try as much as possible to ensure that everything is done, and is done right, and is done all around. We've been talking about I don't even see any discussion around the ransom, because the ransoms were paid, and the tradition is that police will deny the ransom
were paid.
Let me
just halt you there. We just take this quick break, and when we come back, we'll talk more. It's still Journalist Hangout. We'll be right back. Stay with us. Welcome back. So, Journalist Hangout, we're talking about the menace of kidnappers all around the country now. Judy, even from the far north, these headsmen, they're making bricks and business from kidnapping too.
Yes, Kaduna especially. Kidnapping is very rampant in Kaduna now. And they just go after politicians, House of Assembly members, House of Reps members. It's dangerous to travel on the Abuja Kaduna Highway.
Now, that same highway that they want us to spend 6 weeks.
If you are not careful, they will pick you up. In fact, if you are not lucky, not if you are not careful. If you are not lucky, you get picked up. So it's spreading across. Look at Maiduguri. One politician was kidnapped just last week.
Not Boko Haram.
They came to him dressed like policemen. That's why I think that even some of the tricks that they use, Nigerians need to know some of the tricks that they use. So that if someone comes to you dressed like a policeman, you need to ask questions. Mm. They just came to him dressed like a policeman, and they said he was under arrest, and they took him away. Mm. In a long time, kidnapping had not happened in Maiduguri, because that's the safest city in Nigeria. Mm. It's heavily defended. You see soldiers everywhere. A single hotel, you could see like 4 soldiers guiding it, and armored tanks get driven around town. But this guy still went to Maiduguri to operate. So it's now, it's a crime that has assumed cross-country dimension. It's no longer there was a time that Aba was the kidnap capital of Nigeria.
Aba, Abia.
But they pumped soldiers into Aba. The operation was tremendous. And at the end of the day, they got the kingpins. Today, kidnapping no longer takes place in Aba the way it used to. In those days, if you are driving on the Port Harcourt Aba highway, they will chase you down and take you away, leave your car. It was really, I'm talking about like 2011, 2012. Mm. But it shows that, look, if our security agencies really want to do their jobs, they can reduce, they can stem the tide of kidnapping. But technology is the key, because when they begin to talk to one another, you should be able to track
conversations.
Then people, we also need to be vigilant. The people around us, people who are jobless, you see them, they go out, you know, at night, they come back feeling hip, feeling like rich people. You need to ask questions. We need to learn to report people. Of course, our people will also complain that sometimes you report to the police.
Mm.
The police will now tell the victim that, look, is this person? Yes. And then they will come after you. It has happened. So people must have sufficient faith in the police before they can even rat on criminals in their neighborhood. So there is a lot that we need to do to defeat this. In Kogi State now, Kogi, I think the local Jakaba Highway is one of the most dangerous in Nigeria too. They will pick you up on the road. In Kogi State, people will break your door and take you away. It's no, they believe that they can only survive by kidnapping people. It's a big problem in Kogi State now. People are even scared of going home. You go home for a party, you get kidnapped. So people are scared. So it's across the country that we have this problem. The government must figure out how to address this problem. A lot of our schools are located, you know, far away from town. Some of them surrounded by overgrown weeds and all that. These guys, it will create some form of foliage for these guys, so that they will come in freely to take people away. The Babinting school, yes, look at the school. It's like building a school in the heart of a forest. So those guys were able to come in without being suspected. They broke the wall. No matter how tall your wall is, they can drill a hole in the wall. They broke the wall and then got into the school and took the kids away. And they've not stopped. They continue to go to those vulnerable schools to kidnap.
Should there be like a national legislation? Some states they've passed it into law, making kidnapping recommending capital punishment.
That is if he dies in your hands. Yes. The Lagos,
to be honest, I think we unfortunately, like I keep saying, we have this practice in Nigeria of dealing with problems as if we're expecting some magical solution. So then we tend to go overboard and try to get extreme measures. You know, abroad, kidnapping does not warrant the death penalty. You know, it's maybe 8 to 10 years in prison, you know. But we are not looking at it.
Trying to discourage it.
But we are, yes, but we are not, we're not, that's my point. We're not looking at it properly.
It's not discouraging.
We're not looking at it properly. Like I keep saying, you need to, a lot of us, we don't seem to realize that studies show, you know, all over the world that if an area is poor, the likelihood of you finding terrorism, kidnappings, all of those things rise significantly by, I can't remember how many percent. You need to tackle, first of all, in each of the communities, underdevelopment. The fact that, why is it that in 21st century Nigeria today, you find roads that are basically still dirt roads? You take a picture of a place in 1930, 2016, the picture is basically still the same, and you think those people are not going to lash out at anybody they think has money to pay for a ransom or whatever. We need to talk about, you know, the real underlying issues and not just symptoms, you know. That's the first thing. So then the second thing is now our police officers. Our force needs to be fundamentally restructured. You have kidnappers who are graduates and police officers tackling the issue who are not graduates. Detectives abroad, to be a detective, it's a minimum, most of them have first degrees, almost masters, and they go to training colleges every 2-3 years to up to their game, you know, to find out what are the latest technologies, latest ways of tracking down, blah, 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 and all of that.
Psychology, you know, of the kidnapper.
There are so many things that we are not doing here, and yet we are surprised that the same horrible things keep happening over and over and over again. So for me, no, it's not about the death penalty. Death penalty is one thing, but you know what? You raise the stakes. And when you raise the stakes, what happens is people who are already desperate, it doesn't necessarily discourage them. It just means that they are going to up their ransom.
They'll
up their ransom because they know that this is a risk. It's a do or die. So instead of charging, let's say, 20 million or 10 million, they will charge 50 or even 100, knowing maybe that because you are so desperate to get your ward back, you might, if you have contact with your state governor or local government chairman or whatever, they know that the pressure in the society is so much that they can count on you needing to reach out to whoever you can reach out to get that money. And Nigerians do it. These parents, they're not necessarily parents who are upper middle class or wealthy or multimillionaires, but even if they have to borrow the money, they'll go and borrow the money. And the kidnappers know that. So it's not about the death penalty. It's about looking at the real issues in each of these communities. You have schools, like he said, that are built in areas surrounded by bushes. There is nowhere in the world where, first of all, you let weed or grass grow to someone's hip or midriff without it being tended to. So in all of this issue, for me, there's just one underlying factor. As basic as that, one underlying factor, corruption. Local governments, if each of them could utilize their budget to do what in other countries people take for granted, provide light so that, in fact, a kidnapper does not feel so secure in cover of darkness to just attack anybody, pay the security agencies as and when due so that they are even motivated to serve the community. So that when I come and complain to them that, oh, I saw this person that looks suspect, they don't just brush me away because they haven't been paid and they have other issues that they are facing. So, you know, fundamental issues that we are not facing. Instead, we bring in things that look pretty on paper or that sound, that make good headlines. Okay, we now have death penalty, but has that really solved the issue? At the end of the day, I doubt it.
Jola, it seems the level of sophistication of these kidnappers, we've spoken about it, and they are not just people with ordinary, you know, the regular guns and everything. But when we see the way they communicate, I have a call. Shola is calling us from Lagos. Thank you for joining us, Shola. Ade Shino. Hello, Shino.
Ade Shino from...
Okay, go ahead with your contribution, Shino.
Good evening, Ayo.
Good evening. Yes, Shino.
Good evening, Babatunde and the co-guest.
All right, go ahead.
The rate in which kidnapping is unfortunate, the rate at which kidnapping is taking place is happening in this country. But I want us to know that a country where everyone is allowed to do what he likes, and we are not our brother's keeper as we ought to be, we continue to have this problem. I came in listening to Baba Jide, and you see, the securities as of now we are, there is still limited of a sort to carry out a total holistic operation, taking out the hideout of these kidnappers. But I want to tell you that as I'm talking to you, there is a town in the north that if you should enter that town within 24 hours, they will come after you to know where you are, where you're coming from. And I can tell you this because I've been in the north, I'm just coming from the north, and I can tell you that if we can...
Thank you, Shino. I have to take my break, Shino. Still ahead. Journalists Hangout. Northern governors vow to collectively fight insecurity and poverty. Details after this break. Stay with us. Welcome back. Northern governors and traditional rulers have converged to discuss and condemn the worsening security and poverty level in many parts of the region, resolving to find a common solution to these problems. The governor of Borno State and chairman of the Northern Governors Forum, Kashim Shettima, said the meeting with traditional rulers have become crucial because of the fundamental debates bordering on educational backwardness, pervasive poverty, and underdevelopment, as well as persistent insecurity in northern Nigeria. Was this meeting mere medicine after death? Adeola, in the north, educational backwardness, pervasive poverty, and underdevelopment.
Yeah. So,
time and time again, when we look at these people, and some of them, they call them Amajiri, and you see them, and the level of education, young children going to schools, I'm sure the enrollment level, even when we were enrolling for JAMB those days, they would call some states educational disadvantaged states, and they would just try to encourage them. But so many years after, we are still not there. What is responsible, especially in the northern part of the country?
Okay, looking at the decision by the 19 northern state governors and some traditional rulers, you could see that, fine, it may be described as medicine after death, but it's better come than late. The Boko Haram insecurity issue in the north became so, serious in 2009. Mm. And 2009 till date is about
when Boko Haram started striking.
And this has led to the death of between 20,000 and 50,000 people. It has led to the displacement of 2.3 million people. So people can, with that background, say it's a medicine after death. But to my mind, I think it's better late than never. I felt so happy that they are realizing that there is a cardinal problem in that part of the country, and it requires a very, very serious solution. Them coming together is a very good thing. It's a very, very good omen. And I think, just like we said when we were discussing kidnapping, they should, as much as trying to curb insecurity, include the problem of insecurity into the discussion they are having and the solution they think they will prefer to that. So, to me, it's a very good thing that they are coming up with that. If you look at that region very well, you've talked about poverty, you've talked about illiteracy, you've talked about everything that can, make insecurity to grow. You've talked about everything. All those things can trigger violence. All those things are in that part of the country. And I think they should be sincere this time around to make sure that a solution is preferred to the problem.
Okay, my colleague Tessie Makande actually attended that meeting.
Second day of the meeting, but on this day only the governors were here. As usual, they went behind closed doors and were there for hours. Stepping out, they said security in the region remains top on their agenda.
The issues of kidnapping were examined. The issue of herdsmen farmers problem were examined. And Kano State, we have specific areas like the Falgore Forest, which kidnapping has been taking place there, but we have succeeded in rooting it out.
It was then time for the communique to be read. Chairman of the forum said beyond insecurity, revitalizing the region's economy was also discussed.
Resuscitation of Kaduna Textiles Mills Limited, KTL, establishment of a financial institution, exploration of solar power as an alternative source of energy, as well as solid minerals. The forum resolved that the management of NNDC should evolve a comprehensive business plan and present to the forum at the April 2017 meeting.
The northern governors have always met and had resolutions, but implementation of such resolutions has been questionable. To this, the governor said they are about to change the narrative.
From Sokoto to Makurdi, from Maiduguri to Ilorin, our leaders are up and doing. And in the fullness of time, I believe our efforts shall start bearing fruits, and very soon too.
They commended the Plateau State governor and his Kaduna counterpart on their peace efforts. They said it's unfortunate the crisis is usually exacerbated by elements within, in conjunction with foreigners. But they assured that addressing the issue collectively would sort things out. One for all, and all for one, they assured would remain their watchword. They believe things will be a lot better that way. Tessem Akinde, TVC News, Kaduna.
All right, Chidi, reviewing this governor's coming together and trying to combat the menace of poverty and backwardness in the north. But since 1960, we've had our leaders, basically military leaders and some of them, particularly military leaders, coming from the northern part of the country. Yes. Yet that region has not felt, you know, the presence of governance so much in that place.
You see, a lot of the leaders from the north are very selfish. They only think about themselves and members of their family. The exception, of course, is President Buhari, and that's why he's so popular in the north, because the feeling the people have is, oh, he's not one of the oppressors. You know, they do not see him demonstrate affluence, yes, mm-hmm. like these guys. The former governor of Niger State was saying at that meeting that if all of us were like Sadauna, we won't be battling corruption in the north. Of course, he was right, because none of the current crop of leaders, you know, can say that he has the vision and the mission of Sadauna. Hmm. The projects that Sadauna instituted, these leaders from the north watched those projects, those companies crumble. Hmm. The governor of Borno was talking about Kaduna Textile Limited. Mm-hmm. And of course, we have the Arewa Textile. Mm-hmm. Arewa Textile, that's where Oshomole actually came from. He was their PRO in the 90s, you know. Those textile mills have died. Those textile mills used to be the identity of the north. Mm-hmm. But they watched those textile mills die. You go there now, nothing is happening. Those mills have been taken over by rodents. And these leaders do not have the shame to do something about it. I've watched them talk repeatedly from my days as a young journalist in the north. These northern governors have always come together, but they've achieved nothing over the years. They will come, talk. They will not do anything. Just wait. You will see that all of what they talked about now, they will not do it. That's the way they are. They will not do it. But when they leave office, they will be talking about the regrets that they have and all that. I don't know how difficult it is to make your people better. Go and look at school enrollment. Go and even look at how many people sit for JAMB in the northern states. Even Kaduna, I'm happy that Erufai admitted it the other day, that Kaduna is still very, very backward educationally. And Kaduna is supposed to be one of the best in the north. You see, in some cases, maybe only 200 will sit for JAMB in one of the northern states. Just 200. 200, one center in Oyo State will have more than 200. So people they have not done enough for the people. The Borno governor was saying, see, that for just 5,000 naira, because some of the poorest people in Nigeria and the north, especially in the northeast, that for just 5,000 naira, poor old women would take money from Boko Haram and help them to keep their weapons in their huts. They help them to move around those weapons. Mm-hmm. And the poor children too, in the northeast, for even less than that amount, they will volunteer information about the vulnerability of Nigerian troops to Boko Haram, so that Boko Haram can come and kill our soldiers. Mm. So because you have allowed backwardness and poverty to fester in your area, now you have insecurity. Mm. Headsmen are killing people everywhere.
It will give birth to that, definitely.
Yes, headsmen are killing people in Adamawa State. They can't do anything about it. People are being killed in Southern Kaduna. Mm. Even after they signed the so-called peace accord, they are still killing people in Southern Kaduna. So it's something that they should be worried about. But I expect them to take things seriously this time. We are tired of these 19 northern governors coming together and just talk and talk without substance.
It's about that region is about the most backward region in Nigeria, because as journalists we've traveled and we look at it. Even in the Niger Delta region, you can see areas that, you know, they are coming up, and education is not as bad as what it is in the north. And if the situation is so bad and they have to live with it. There was a time the former president actually established some Amajiri schools. I don't know what has become of those schools now.
No, I think so. First off, I don't like the word backward. You know, it's a bit offensive, and the problem with that is it feeds into this.
It feeds into this narrative.
No, I know, but listen. This is my point. Let me finish.
So that they don't.
Let me finish.
That
it feeds into this narrative of North versus South. What Southerners are calling them backward, and are saying that their religion or whatever. No, that's how the interpretation. You have to be careful how you say things, so that the person in front of you does not lose your message. Does not lose your message. No, it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. My point. Let me finish. My point is that how we dialogue and interact with each other matters. The words that we use. You can call, it's like Black American slang. They call each other nigger, but can a white person call them, hey nigger? No, it doesn't happen, you know. But that's besides the point. There's a lot of hypocrisy and insincerity, you know, in the North and all over Nigeria, because we refuse to, like I keep saying, go to the root cause of issues in the North. You know, we're talking about the Sardona earlier. There has been this idea, you know, almost since Nigeria's formation, this one North idea and of an identity that binds them together using Islam. But the truth of the matter, if we want to really be sincere and say things that might not be popular but that are true, is that the Islam that was adopted in Nigeria is a repressive, regressive kind of Islam. You'll understand why I said that. In Saudi Arabia, in Abu Dhabi, in Dubai, there are Muslims also who practice the same religion. The difference between them and between Northern Nigeria is leadership. Their leadership there is committed to doing something for the people, irrespective of what their personal beliefs about anything are, you know. You go to a place like Saudi Arabia or to even Libya, education is either free or subsidized to the level that the poorest person can afford to send their child to at least a minimum of primary school education. We don't have
it's
that here.
Issue of,
we don't have
leadership.
That here. So the issue is really leadership. So we watch them, you know, all our leaders over the country bemoan issues. You know, it's unfortunate. It's, you know, and then they condole with victims that are victims as a result of all these issues. But I think that what really needs to happen is we need to have real conversations about what are the problems and what are solutions. Because all these media-friendly pictures and glitz and glam and all that, that's not going to solve anything. Soundbites don't solve anything.
All right, Diola, when you look at the situation now and you begin to, especially what has happened in northeastern parts, at Adamawa, Yobe, and Borno State, Borno, I don't know how that state can recover, Borno, if the devastation is so enormous, and it will take, you know, years and years and years to touch the life of people, especially looking at the people inside the IDP camps all around.
It will be very, 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 very tough for them to recover, but I'm optimistic that they can recover, depending on sincerity.
Yeah.
Mark the word sincerity. Yes. If the leadership is sincere and the followership is sincere, it's not a situation when they have done bad to the followership, so to say, and by the time it's election period, they dash you 1,500, 200, and you vote for them. So if we begin to check the excesses of the leaders, they will know that these are the set of people that will question us when we don't deliver on our promises.
Let me take this call from Bauchi State. Nura is calling us from Bauchi State. Thank you for joining us, Nura.
How are you?
Yes, sir. Nura.
Hello, Ayo.
Hello, how are you? Thank you for joining us. Go ahead with your contribution.
I'm fine.
All right, go ahead, Nura.
How are you?
Fine.
Fine.
Keep talking.
Noura, you are listening to yourself. All right, let me quickly take this break. We'll be right back after this timeout. Stay with us. It's still Journalist Hangout. To take our last take on this and the level of underdevelopment in this part of the country, as yes. we are talking about Niger Delta development, and I think there should be a development efforts to, you know, all hands to be on deck to develop the northern part of Nigeria.
It is up to those leaders. It is up to those leaders to do the right thing. We can talk for hours here about how desirable development is. But if the leaders choose not to do the right thing, there is nothing anyone can do. They have to focus on programs that deliver good to the majority of the people. That's talking about utilitarianism. But they just think about themselves. And I'm happy that even some of them come out to say, look, we have failed Sadauna. We have watched structures that he built collapse because of our selfishness. That none of us today, you know, can say that he has not failed Sadauna. We've seen my Babangida Aliu come out to say that publicly. You know, he even still said it again yesterday. So the northern leaders, the governors need to look at themselves in the mirror and ask themselves whether they've done well enough for their people. The Katsina governor, I keep saying Katsina, the Borno governor said poverty is the greatest monster behind the backwardness of the north. Those were his exact words. So they know that their people have been left backward. So what they need to do now is redress the situation so that they can at least catch up with the rest of Nigeria.
Tibia, education will also play a big role in this, because if you're educated, it's like a kind of liberation. You won't have people on the street and...
No, definitely. But the right kind of education. You know, we mentioned the Amajiri schools earlier. We have this practice in Nigeria of, okay, so under Jonathan, it was popular to start a university. And there was this grand idea or grand plan of every state having a university. But what's the content of what is being taught in those universities? You know, it's the same thing, whether it's primary, whether secondary, whether university. Schools are underfunded in Nigeria, teachers underpaid, even the teachers, wrong kind of teachers who barely even know or understand what it is that they are teaching. You know, all of this has to do with the mind and the kind of citizen that we are creating, which we never think of in Nigeria. We think it's just learn to read and write and then leave school and you're okay. No, why do people fall prey to all of this, terrorism and all that? It's also because of what happens. Poverty of the mind, they say, is the greatest form of poverty, not even poverty of not being able to feed yourself, you know. So the North needs to tackle two things, the culture. There's a culture, it's not a popular thing to say, but the Emir of Kano said so about a few days ago that child marriages are part of the issue. You know, in the sense that when a girl gets married at 10, 12 and is sick after childbirth and dies and that child is abandoned, what is going to happen to that child? You know, so there's so many of these issues that need to be tackled in a really holistic approach if we really want to see development in the North.
Jola?
I get back to sincerity again. The northern elders and leaders across the country have been said to be insincere. And if you weigh their actions, you know that there is gross insincerity. If you have told people that you are going to do this when voted to power, and at the end of the day, you are not being sincere. And the insincerity on the part of the followers, we don't question them. We don't question them. By the time you want to question them, they throw up religion. They throw up ethnic.
So well.
So with that, Nigeria is a country that people will say, yes, he's a thief. He's our son, so he's our thief. It's so ridiculous. So until we are sincere about everything.
I know that one. Yeah. All right, moving on now. The Nigerian army has continued to maintain its stand that it is winning the war against Boko Haram. The army claims to have decimated the group, but the remaining are still capable of carrying out deadly attacks. Last Monday, Boko Haram terrorists invaded Zako village in Askira Oba area of Borno State, killed 8 persons and abducted an unspecified number of women and children. Earlier today, 1 civilian vigilante and 3 suicide bombers were killed after 2 suicide bombs rocked Maiduguri in Borno State. Does the army have the counter strategy to prevent this attack? And after we've taken Sambisa Forest, Jide, after the exploits in Sambisa Forest, these people, they seem to, targeting, looking at soft targets around and carrying out suicide bombings. Especially now, Maiduguri is very, very, volatile.
They are still capable of carrying out the kind of attacks they carried out in the past. Let's stop deceiving ourselves that it's only the soft targets that they are going after. Last week, they attacked the military in their barracks. They went to Buniyadi to attack a military formation. After they left Sambisa, they left with all their weapons in Sambisa. So they still have the weapons of war with which they can cause havoc. So nobody should deceive us that they can no longer carry out military-style attacks, because we've seen them attack the military, take the battle to the military after they left Sambisa. I said it that the threat to our troops for a long time was not even coming from Sambisa. The threat to our troops, those threats were coming from the Lake Chad, around the Lake Chad area. Malam Faturi, where Abu Ali was killed, and all those threats didn't come from Sambisa. Gashigeri, where they killed dozens of our soldiers and some of them were floating on the Yobe River. That threat did not come from the Sambisa area. So we have warned on this program before that the Lake Chad area will be the last area of real battle between Nigerian army and Boko Haram. But we are even seeing them attacking communities that we thought were safe as far back as 2015. They are still kidnapping women. Remember, in my Mother Gali, we carried the story almost 2 weeks ago that they went there, seized women and children, and went away. As Kira is about 180 kilometers to Maiduguri and is close to the border with Adamawa, which means it's not really far from the Madagali Michika axis. So the guys still constitute threats in some parts of Nigeria. It is not only in Sambisa that you can set up camps. You can set up camps. There are, in fact, other forests where they can hibernate, where they can hide. So we need to improve on our intelligence gathering so that we can locate areas where they are. But the other problem is they don't even stay in one place. They are constantly moving, setting up camps here, move to somewhere else, move from Ran. Because they had been attacking us in Ran, that was why it was they attacked us in Ran at least 2 times within the last few months. They attacked the soldiers. They went to meet our soldiers there. So maybe that's why they felt, look, these guys, there must be high concentration of the terrorists in Ran. And then they drop bombs on IDPs. Mm. So the thing is, let's improve the intelligence gathering architecture so that we can locate the areas where they are. But for now, they still constitute a threat to us. Just very much like Al-Shabaab in Mogadishu. You cannot say you've defeated Al-Shabaab because they still continue to kill people.
Tabia, on the long run, what should we do to make sure that these guys don't carry out formidable attacks again?
Well, I think we need to improve the work that seemed to have started but hasn't really gone very far, with our neighbors, especially Chad. There have been a lot of reports that say that, in fact, most African countries, the borders are so porous, but the Chad, Nigeria, all that Lake Chad area is just like one big community. People, go in and out into the different villages that surround that whole area. So the question really is, how are we working with Chad to make sure that that area is concentrated on, because a lot of times what you find out is that the Boko Haram people live in Chad. A lot of them, their houses, their families, people know them the same way people know us here. So they're actually fairly easy to identify if we really decide that we want to end this thing once and for all. So it needs a concentrated effort.
Jola, your final take on this quickly.
Okay. Let me try as much as possible to correct an impression. The Chad that we are talking about now is not the Chad Republic per se. There are areas in Nigeria, like I've been there for like Marte, like a lot of areas like Oba. That. Yeah, that they do. The time I was there as a young as a journalist, I was asking people. That was during the regime of Obasanjo. You will not believe that they do not know who was Obasanjo. They do not.
Civilization.
No, truth of the matter is that they are far. There is no government presence there, so they do not understand anything about Nigeria. Some of them do not even know there's a country called Nigeria. They relate more with Chad Republic than Nigeria.
Wow.
So, but my take on this is that the problem has now fine. The military has told us that they've been able to defeat Boko Haram, but we are still seeing attacks. But at this point in time, I believe. The military will need our support, more of our support this time around. And the Nigerian police, this is a time that we need more activities from the Nigerian police.
Understand it.
You know, yes, we need to do a lot because in Nigeria, we still have about 370,000
police. Diola, I have to go! Yeah. Oh, thank you. Yeah. Thank you, Diola. Thank you, Tevia and Babajide. And that's it on Journalist Hangout today. Join us for another exciting episode of the program. You can watch the repeat broadcast tonight. I'm Ayodele Uzubakwu. See you tomorrow.